Chapter 13, The Challenges of Growth. Growth is a complex process, facing many challenges. Can we be confident that technological progress can continue at the same rate? Should we be worried that robots will destroy jobs and lead to mass unemployment? Does everybody really benefit from the increased standard of living? And in the process of growing, aren't we destroying the planet and mortgaging our future? Chapter 13 Outline, The Challenges of Growth. Section 13.1 discusses the future of technological progress. Section 13.2 discusses whether technological progress, such as robots, will lead to mass unemployment. Section 13.3 discusses the relation between growth and inequality. Section 13.4 discusses climate change. General theme of this chapter is that growth is a complex process and policies to make it fair and sustainable are of the essence. Chapter 12 concludes that in the long run, technological progress is the key to increases in the standard of living. Yet technological progress is often blamed for higher unemployment, higher income inequality, and more damage to the environment. We take up those issues in this chapter. Section 13.1, The Future of Technological Progress. Some economists believe that the era of major inventions is largely over, and we should expect technological progress to slow down considerably. Others believe instead that we are on the verge of another technological revolution and the future is bright. In the next slide, we will look at the arguments on both sides. Looking around us, we have the impression of fast technological change, be it the introduction of robots, the development of artificial intelligence, the use of machine learning, or more concretely, the number of applications that we can use on our smartphones. One might have expected this to be reflected in higher measured productivity growth. Yet, as we saw in Table 1.2 in Chapter 1, US measured productivity growth has slowed down since the mid-2000s, running at less than half the rate of earlier decades. One possible reason that we see such rapid advances in technology that appear to have little impact on productivity growth is due to measurement error. Measuring technological progress is difficult. For example, how much better is a 2018 computer relative to a 2010 computer? Could it be, therefore, that we understate the rate of productivity growth and that the true rate is higher? If productivity growth has declined, it might be explained by the magnitude of innovation. Some argue that the current major innovations are less important than the major innovations of the past. Major innovations are innovations that have applications in many fields and many products. For this reason, these innovations are called general purpose technologies. These major innovations have an impact that lasts decades after their introduction. They transform methods of production and life in general in often dramatic ways. Robert Gordon has studied the history of technological innovations and argues that the two major innovations of the last 150 years were electricity and the internal combustion engine. Others, such as Eric Brynjolfsson, argue that digitization, together with increasing power of computers, will transform our lives as much as or more than electricity or the internal combustion engine did earlier. Who is right? Who is wrong? The honest answer is that nobody really knows. There are a number of spectacularly wrong predictions, including that of Thomas Watson, former CEO of IBM, who in 1943 said, "I think there is a world market for maybe 5 computers." Section 13.2, Robots and Unemployment. Since the Industrial Revolution, workers have worried about being replaced by technology. The theme of technological unemployment typically resurfaces whenever unemployment is high. However, in its crudest form, the argument that technological progress must necessarily lead to higher unemployment is obviously false. During the Great Depression, a movement called the Technocracy Movement argued that high unemployment came from the introduction of machinery and that things would only get worse if technological progress were allowed to continue. The large improvements in the standard of living that advanced countries enjoy have come with large increases in employment and no increase in the unemployment rate. These increases in the standard of living coincided with increasing productivity. More sophisticated versions of the technological unemployment hypothesis, however, must be taken more seriously. In the United States, real output per person has increased by a factor of 10 since 1890, and far from declining, employment has increased by a factor of 6.5, reflecting a parallel increase in the size of the US population. Figure 13.1 plots average US labor productivity growth and the average unemployment rate during each decade since 1890. At first glance, there seems to be little relation between the two, but if we ignore the 1930s, the Great Depression, a relation emerges between productivity growth and the unemployment rate. But it is the opposite of the relation predicted by those who believed in technological unemployment. Periods of high productivity growth like the 1940s to the 1960s have been associated with a lower unemployment rate. Periods of low productivity growth, such as the United States saw during the 2010 to 2018, have been associated with a higher unemployment rate. However, this past relationship may not hold in the future. By their very nature, they can replace the least skilled workers. A recent study concludes that over the next 2 decades, 47% of US workers are at risk of being replaced by robots. A study by Darren Acemoglu and Pasquale Restrepo of MIT, looking at the evidence on the effect of the introduction of robots on employment in local labor markets, concludes that where they are introduced, robots do indeed destroy jobs. It is possible that robots may create other jobs to replace the ones eliminated. To date, robots have not led to higher unemployment. Section 13.3, Growth, Churn, and Inequality. Economist Joseph Schumpeter emphasized the process of growth was fundamentally a process of creative destruction. New goods are developed, making old ones obsolete. New techniques of production are introduced, requiring new skills and making some old skills less useful. As this happens, old jobs are eliminated, new jobs are created. Even for those with the right skills, the firm where they work may be replaced by a more efficient firm, or the product their firm was selling may be replaced by another product. Many professions from those of blacksmiths to harness makers have vanished forever. There were more than 11 million farm workers in the United States at the beginning of the 20th century. Because of high productivity growth in agriculture, there are fewer than 1 million today. By contrast, there are now more than 3 million truck, bus, and professional car drivers. There were none in 1900. Focus: job destruction, churn, and earnings losses. The vertical axis of the graph is labeled percent loss in earnings from being laid off, ranging from negative 45 to 10 in increments of 5. The horizontal axis of the graph is labeled years before and after job loss in mass layoff, ranging from negative 6 to 20 in increments of 1. This focus box explores the tension between the large gains for society from technological change and the potentially large costs for the workers who lose their jobs. A study by Steve Davis and Till Von Wachter, who used records from the Social Security Administration between 1974 and 2008 to look at what happens to workers who lose their job as a result of a massive layoff. Figure 1 summarizes their results. If the mass layoff happened during a recession, a laid-off worker's earnings fell by 40 percentage points relative to a worker who did not experience a mass layoff. Also, the decline in earnings persisted for years after the layoff. A mass layoff is thus associated with a substantial decline in lifetime earnings. So although technological change is the main source of growth in the long run and clearly enables a higher standard of living for the average person, workers who experience mass layoffs are clear losers. Figure 13.2 shows the evolution of relative wages for various groups of workers by education level since 1973. Since the early 1980s, the relative wages of workers with a low education level have fallen. The relative wages of workers with a high education level have risen. The vertical axis of the graph is labeled relative wage by level of education, ranging from 0.8 to 1.4 in increments of 0.1. The horizontal axis of the graph represents the years from 1973 to 2015 in increments of 3 years. For those in growing sectors or those with the right skills, technological progress leads to new opportunities and higher wages. But for those in declining sectors or those with skills that are no longer in demand, technological progress can mean the loss of their job, a period of unemployment, and possibly much lower wages. The main force behind the increase in the wage of high-skill relative to low-skill workers is a steady increase in the demand for high-skill workers relative to the demand for low-skill workers. This trend in relative demand is not new, but it appears to have strengthened. Two possible reasons for this shift are: 1. The role of international trade. U.S. firms that employ higher proportions of low-skill workers, the argument goes, are increasingly driven out of markets by imports from similar firms in low-wage countries. 2. The other line of argument has focused on skill-biased technological progress. New machines and new methods of production, the argument goes, require more and more high-skill, high-education workers. Focus: technology, education, and inequality. Figure 1 shows wage differentials and the Returns to Education, 1939 to 1995. There are two lessons to be drawn from this evidence. This focus box shows how, one, not only the demand, but also the supply of skills shaped the evolution of wage inequality in the United States during the 20th century. We note that technological progress, even when skill biased, that is accompanied by an increase in the demand for skilled and educated workers, does not necessarily increase economic inequality. For the first three quarters of the 20th century, the increase in demand for skills was more than met by increase in the supply of skills, leading to decreasing inequality. As shown in Figure 1, the return to one more year of college was high in the 1940s, 11% for young women and 10% for all men. This induced families to keep their children in school longer and send them to college. The increase in the supply of workers lowered both returns to education and the wage differential. By the 1950s, the return to one more year of college had fallen to 8% for young men, 9% for all men. By the 1990s, rates of return were back to the 1930s level. The return to a year of college today is higher than in the 1930s. Since then, demand growth has continued, whereas supply growth has decreased, leading once again to increasing inequality. 2. Although market forces provide incentives for demand to respond to wage differentials, institutions are also important. For most Americans in the early 20th century, access to schooling, at least through high school, was largely unlimited. Education was publicly provided and funded, and thus free of direct charge. Another dimension of inequality, however, is the proportion of income that accrues to the richest households. When we consider inequality at very high levels of income, wages are not a good measure of income. The top 1% of the income distribution derive a large portion of income from capital income and capital gains. The top 1% are typically paid both through wages and through company shares that they can sell, with some limitations, at a profit. Figure 13.3 shows the evolution of the top 1% and the bottom 50% income shares in the United States since 1913. The evolution of the top 1% share shown in Figure 13.3 is striking. The share of income going to households in the top 1% steadily decreased from the 1930s until the late 1970s. Since then, however, it has increased sharply from about 9% to 22% today. By contrast, the share of the bottom 50% has sharply decreased from about 21% in the early 1970s. Data are not available before 1965 to less than 13% today. Is it possible for countries to sustain growth without having ever increasing inequality? There are two reasons for optimism. One, not all advanced economies are like the United States. Wage inequality and the share of the top 1% have been rising in most countries, but typically much less than in the United States. Two, we must distinguish between market income inequality, which is income inequality before taxes and transfers, and disposable income inequality, which is income after taxes and transfers. So far, we have looked at market inequality, but what matters in the end is disposable income inequality. And here again, not all advanced economies are like the United States. The Gini coefficient discussed in the next slide helps us look at inequality. Focus: inequality and the Gini coefficient. The Gini coefficient is a measure of inequality. The best way to describe it is with the picture above. The share of population ranked by increasing income is plotted on the horizontal axis from 0 to 1. The share of income is plotted on the vertical axis from 0 to 1. The relation giving the share of income associated with a given population share is given by the convex curve in red. If the distribution was perfectly equal, such that everybody has the same income, so the share of income is always equal to the share of population, the relation between the share of income associated with a given population would be given by the diagonal blue curve. The Gini coefficient is given by the ratio of area A, area between the blue curve and the red curve, to area A plus B, where area B is the area under the red curve. In case of equal distribution of income, area A is 0, and thus the Gini coefficient is also equal to 0. Take the opposite extreme and consider an economy where all the income goes to the richest individual. Then the relation between the two is a flat line covering the horizontal axis, ending with a jump from 0 to 1 at the end. Area B is equal to 0, and so the Gini coefficient is equal to 1. Gini coefficients typically range between 0.2 and 0.6. The further away the red curve is from the blue curve, higher the Gini coefficient is, and greater is the degree of inequality. Figure 13.4, which compares the evolution of both types of inequality in the United States and in France, makes the two points we talked about on slide 19 clearly. The two series at the top show the evolution of the Gini coefficients for market income inequality for the United States in red and for France in blue. The Gini for the United States goes up over time, reflecting the wage and top 1% income increasing inequalities we discussed earlier. The Gini for France, however, remains roughly constant. The two series at the bottom show the evolution of the Gini coefficients for disposable income inequality for the two countries. Again, there is a striking contrast between them. While the Gini coefficient for the United States goes up by about half of the increase in the market Gini coefficient, the Gini coefficient for France is lower today than it was in the 1980s. There are strong moral reasons to want to limit inequality to achieve what is known as inclusive growth. There are also good political reasons for governments to do so. To reduce inequality, governments can try to reduce market inequality through better education, through minimum wages, and through rules about governance within firms. Or, given market income inequality, they can reduce disposable income inequality through progressive taxation, including the use of a negative income tax to increase revenue at the low end of the wage distribution, and through transfers such as food stamps and unemployment benefits. All governments use some of these tools, and redistribution can substantially reduce inequality. Evidence from a recent OECD study is given in figure 13.5, which shows the Gini coefficients multiplied by 100 associated with market income and with disposable income and by implication shows the degree of redistribution for each OECD country. The figure yields three conclusions. 1. Countries vary widely in their degree of inequality, with the United States near the top. Gini coefficients range from lows of 30% in Korea and 34% in Iceland to 50% in Ireland and Greece and 48% in the United States. 2. The degree of redistribution, defined as the difference in market income Gini and the disposable income Gini, divided by the market income Gini, varies from lows of 5% in Chile and 10% in Korea to 38% in Finland and 40% in Ireland. 3. As a result of redistribution, disposable income Gini's are lower than market income Gini's, often by a large amount. In the United States, market income inequality is high and redistribution limited. If inequality continues to increase, governments will have to do more. This is why, for example, it appears that discussions about the marginal income tax rate or higher inheritance taxes are likely to play an important role in the future of U.S. elections. Sustaining growth while limiting or reducing inequality is one of the most important challenges facing policymakers today. Section 13.4, Climate Change and Global Warming. Markets work poorly when there are externalities. A major externality of growth is the emission of greenhouse gases. Since the Industrial Revolution, the use of fossil fuels, primarily coal, has led to a large increase in CO2 emissions. At the same time, there has been a steady increase in the average global temperature. The evidence for each one is shown in figures 13.6 and 13.7 on the next two slides. If there is too much carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, the temperature of the Earth will increase, leading to global warming. Substantial global warming would be catastrophic, leading to a large increase in sea levels, extreme weather events, and parts of the world becoming uninhabitable. Figure 13.6 shows the increase in CO2 emissions since 1850 by region of the world. The vertical axis of the graph represents the annual carbon dioxide emissions in billion tons and ranges from 0 to 40 in increments of 5. The horizontal axis represents the years from 1850 to 2012 in increments of 6. It shows a very large increase in emissions over time, starting with Europe during the Industrial Revolution and the United States taking the relay later. Since the 2000s, however, emissions from China have exceeded the emissions of both Europe and the United States combined. The graph plots the amount of CO2 by USA, European Union, China, India, and other countries. The estimated amount of emission of CO2 by USA over the years is as follows. 1850, 0. 2015, 5. The estimated amount of emission of CO2 by European Union over the years is as follows. 1850, 0.1. 2015, 8. The estimated amount of emissions of CO2 by China over the years is as follows. 1952, 4.5. 2015, 18. The estimated amount of CO2 by India over the years is as follows. 1964, 6.5. 2015, 20.8. The estimated amount of emission of CO2 by other countries over the years is as follows. 1996, 1.5, 2015, 36.2. Figure 13.7 shows the increase in the global average temperature since 1850 as a deviation from the temperature in 1850. It shows that the temperature has increased by roughly 1.2 degrees Celsius since 1850, with much of the increase taking place since the late 1970s. Turning from the past to the future, the main question is how fast global warming is likely to happen. The consensus forecast is shown in figure 13.8. If there were no climate policies at all, temperature would be forecast to increase relative to its value before the pre-industrial revolution by 4.1 to 4.8 degrees Celsius by 2100. Making the planet largely uninhabitable. Under existing policies, the forecast is for an increase of 3.1 to 3.7 degrees, still a catastrophic outcome. Under current pledges, the forecast is for an increase of 2.6 to 3.2 degrees. Pledges, however, are not binding, and the evidence is that many countries are not delivering. Even if they were, the pledged changes would be insufficient to limit the increase to 1.5% to 2%, the level considered acceptable by scientists. The fact that both CO2 levels and the global temperatures have increased is indisputable. Nearly all scientists believe that the relation is indeed causal. Given this evidence, what policies should be adopted by countries to limit the increase of CO2? There is wide agreement among economists that the best policy is to put a price on carbon emissions, in effect to internalize the externality. The reason carbon emissions have not been taxed is probably fourfold. First, until recently, global warming was not seen as a high priority. Second, any policy that implies a cost today in exchange for difficult to assess benefits far in the future is politically difficult to sell. Third, because the relatively poor in each country tend to have cars that are older and have larger emissions, the policy, unless compensated by the right transfers, is regressive. Fourth, and probably more importantly, policy discussions lead to sharp tensions between emerging market and advanced economies. However, Nobel laureate William Nordhaus suggests countries willing to impose a carbon tax should do so and impose carbon tariffs on goods imported from countries that do not have a carbon tax. This would give incentives for those countries to adopt a carbon tax and no longer be subject to tariffs. Whether this or another solution is adopted, the problem will not go away.